Taking here about 320 medical students a year, but there's a whole vast foreign exchange paying student body out there that could be tapped. Now, I raise that because the imperative for internationalization is not just opportunity, it's not just what you could gain, you have to look at our environment. Our public institutions are under pressure because governments are having fiscal problems, and that is limiting their capacity to support public education, especially when it has to compete for resources in secondary and primary education. And in this kind of milieu, one of the ways for universities to enlarge and increase their efficiency and also to improve their financial stability is to go to the global market, both by getting students here and by exporting over the internet. If you look at the student body here, and I say this without bias, UWI is the premier education institution. And out of a student body, we have 20 here at Mona, about 18 at St. Augustine, another of nearly 40,000 students. We have 144 students from the United Kingdom, where we have a vast diaspora. So it must tell you that there's something that there that we're not fully exploiting. Now, what are the challenges in going global? First of all, we're small, but we have quality. And if we can expand over the internet, then supplying a larger student body doesn't mean a vast investment in infrastructure. You can offer an internet course to 10 people or 10,000 people. So we have that challenge, but it can be overcome. Secondly, we face the problem of institutions which don't collaborate effectively, so that each university is doing all the same things that everybody else is doing when we could be sharing. So there are a number of challenges. Another challenge is the cost of getting visibility in the global market. You have to be able to spend some money to be seen and to be heard and to become visible. Even the business of being ranked, you have to pay a fee to be ranked in certain ranking systems, and these are costs. And so if you're going to go global, there is a challenge there. Now, having laid out the challenge, I always believe there is a solution to every problem. And I think we can find it collectively. I am suggesting that the way to meet these challenges is what I call a regional higher education cluster. It's a trans-Caribbean cluster, and it is a market-driven cluster. It's a cluster that involves public, private non-profit, and private for-profit. It does not compromise the integrity of any one institution, but it draws on the strengths of the respective institutions. I maintain there's a lot that public universities can learn from the for-profit institutions without compromising their standards about how to be more efficacious in student treatment, in recruiting, etc. And I believe that this kind of cluster can operate across the Caribbean. And I believe that this cluster can overcome the problems we have been talking about. One of those problems is productivity. I think that sharing, the synergies, the exchange of information, the collaboration can reduce cost and improve our productivity. Secondly, it can increase innovation because we learn from each other and we don't have to reinvent the wheel. Thirdly, we stimulate new synergies associated with this. For example, If all universities collaborated, maybe there'll be more Caribbean publishing. There'll be all kind of spin-offs. These institutions too can help to provide a more diverse and wider range of offerings. You can offer a unique experience. Come to a university in the Caribbean, spend a semester, come to a Caribbean institution, an English-speaking country, spend a semester in a Spanish-speaking country, spend another semester at a different university that's French-speaking, live among different cultures, you begin to produce a more interesting product for the student and a better learning experience. They get a diverse cultural exposure, they become more exposed to the global, and they have a wider set of courses they can choose from. It also gives you economies of scale and scope. And finally, it improves the financial viability because there's a huge global market to be gained. And it brings in foreign exchange, which in some countries is scarce. Now, what do you require to have this higher education Trans-Caribbean cluster? You require the following 10 things. Only the best institutions can participate. This is not for everybody. This is an attempt to raise quality, raise global visibility. There has to be a minimum standard. So only the best. Secondly, we have to build on the existing cooperative arrangements. There are numerous associations of Caribbean tertiary institutions. Some are confined to Caribbean, some include Latin America, some include institutions in the US. There are all these institutions on which we can build. We're not meeting each other in different universities for the first time, but we have not been doing business together. And that's the difference. We can build on that. Thirdly, you need an extensive international marketing and networking campaign. You can't go to the global market as easily as one institution, but if you're going as a whole region of, say, 20 or 30 good universities, then you begin to attract attention. Four, you have to advertise the diversity of the experience and the learning which you can have in this cluster. Fifth, it's a public sector, private sector partnership. There's a lot at public institutions, and I don't make this about any particular institution. I state it as a generality. There's a lot that we can learn from private institutions about being more creative, more nimble, more opportunistic, without compromising quality. And they certainly can up their standards by resorting to what we have to offer in the public sector. Seven, we have to produce these joint degrees. People are looking for joint degrees. You can have joint degrees within the Caribbean, or you can have double degrees between the Caribbean and Africa, Caribbean and the US, for example. University of West Indies is doing a double degree with University of Lagos, doing one with University of Johannesburg. We have an arrangement with University in Suzhou, where we're doing software engineering, 2 years in the Caribbean, 2 years in China. This is the future of education, and we need to get more into it as a collective in the Caribbean. If we really have now to be a global brand, you have to set out to establish yourself visibly, globally. Nine, you have to have physical presence. It's great to be on the internet, great to be in a cluster, but you have to, people have to be able to go somewhere and see your name on a building. Somewhere in London, Tokyo, somewhere else. That is part of the visibility. Look at firms. There's manufacturing in, say, Germany, selling in North America, but you still have to have a physical presence there that the consumer can see and learn from. The last one I'll leave for the, I will suggest that clusters can form naturally, even when they're not market driven, but we need to inject the element of leadership. I will leave it as an exercise for the audience to find out which university I think is best placed to take on this leadership of the cluster. But may I be explicit and say, I think University of Western is as well placed to lead this, and there are benefits in doing this. Now, I would conclude by saying that there is value to the institutions, there's value to the students, there's value to the faculty, exchange, etc. All of this is good. But in addition to this, we could be starting an export sector of higher education, which has the potential to drive economic growth in a sector, in a situation where this was the region worst affected by the global financial crisis. In a situation where we have some sunset industries and where we are finding difficult to diversify our exports, this is something we have a comparative advantage in. This is something that doesn't require great financial capital. It requires ingenuity, and it is not beyond us to create this trans-Caribbean cluster, which can then become the core of a new dynamic sector to drive economic development. And I will close by saying that in doing that, we also improve the sector of higher education in the Caribbean. And no set of countries can become developed without a first-class higher education system. So I leave those thoughts with you as a suggestion as to how we might do good for higher education and for the Caribbean. Thank you very much.